I have a great pleasure in introducing Indira Jaisingh, our second esteemed member of the panel. Ms. Indira Jaisingh is a renowned advocate and human rights activist who was the first woman to be appointed as Additional Solicitor General of India. I have known her when I was in Delhi, participated in some meetings, a Padma Shri awardee. Ms. Jaisingh ranked 20th in the list of 50 great leaders of the world by Fortune magazine in 2018. Along with her husband, Anand Grover, she co-founded the Lawyers Collective, an NGO devoted to feminist and left-wing causes. A huge champion of women's rights and human rights, she has argued several cases relating to discrimination against women, sexual harassment cases, and has also represented the victims of the Bhopal tragedy in the Supreme Court of India. With over 50 years of experience in the Indian judiciary, we are happy to have her and to have her views on the subject.
Before I make my comments on the topic for today's lecture, I would like to make a few relevant comments about the work of former Chief Justice M.N. Venkatchalaya, who has delivered your keynote address today. Whether the judiciary delivers on its promise or not depends on the people who get appointed as judges. Who makes these appointments? It was during the period of his tenure as former CJI, that the Supreme Court made a tectonic shift from judges being appointed primarily by the President of India with the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers to judges being appointed by the judiciary in consultation with the Prime Minister, no doubt. This happened 12 years after a bench of 7 judges of the Supreme Court had decided in the S.P. Gupta case, that the executive would have unlimited powers to appoint judges. Justice Venkatchalaya therefore played a very important role in the development of the journey of appointment of judges. Although he was not a part of that bench, it fell upon his shoulders to make appointments of judges. Many years later, the Supreme Court decided that not just the Chief Justice alone, but a collegium of the Chief together with the 4 senior most judges would make appointments to judges of the Supreme Court, and 3 senior most judges would make appointments to the High Courts. To Justice Venkatchalaya's credit, he made transfers of no less than 50 judges to different High Courts, on the ground that they had their own relatives practicing in those courts. It was perhaps the first attempt to get rid of dynasty and nepotism in the judiciary. He chaired, of course, as we all know, the Constitution Review Committee, made a suggestion that appointments should be made by the Chief Justice for 2 senior most judges of the court and the Law Minister and an outside jurist. This suggestion was not accepted. Many years later, the Judicial Appointments Commission Act was passed, in which once again, the executive took primacy in the matter of appointments. We know that this was struck down by the Supreme Court, returning the power of appointment back to the collegium. But now we need to address the most critical question: has the judiciary delivered on its promise? Has it acted as the arbiter between the rights of the citizen and the executive, which is exactly what Justice Venkatchalaya's speech tells us is the true role of the judiciary under a democracy? An even more fundamental question is, how do judges get appointed at all? From your 3 speakers today, the keynote speaker, Justice Venkatchalaya, Justice Sikri, and me, I am the only one who is a practicing lawyer, and I would choose, therefore, to speak from the point of view of a practicing lawyer. This requires me to go through a very brief history of the legal profession in India. We know that lawyers played a very prominent role in the pre-independence movement. They were deeply engaged with the freedom struggle, and they became what we will describe as the transitional lawyers, those who straddled the world of pre-independence and post-independence. They came to be appointed as attorney generals and solicitor generals. I cannot help commenting that they were well versed in colonial laws and the common laws, but they were only beginners in a regime which guaranteed fundamental rights. We then come to a generation of lawyers who were supported by business houses, whose main challenges were challenges to progressive law and reform laws, to nationalization, and also to liberty. These were lawyers who were supported by business houses. For example, Mr. Palkhiwala was one of them. Those who served the interests of big business and industry and provided them with a platform. They experimented with challenging laws on the ground that they violated fundamental rights. But as Justice Venkat Chelaya himself points out, they failed miserably when it came to the right to liberty. In the case of A.K. Gopalan, it was held that once due process of law is complied with, the reasonableness of the law need not be looked into. I'd like to give now a sociological account of the bar in India since then. The Bombay bar appears to have dominated developments in the country, including in the Supreme Court. They were drawn mainly from among Parsis and Gujaratis. The Calcutta bar was dominated by Bhadraloks, irrespective of the caste and creed to which they belong. The Madras bar was dominated by Tamil Brahmins and the Tram Brahms in pre-independence days. In the post-independence period, the character of the Madras bar appears to have changed in the matter of confronting social justice issues. It is this generation of lawyers who could have been role models for the future of the legal profession in this country. And the reason I go into this is because this is the pool of talent from which we draw our judges. In my opinion, this generation can be characterized as what I call the lumpet generation of lawyers, overly deferential to power and authority, and willing to accept whatever came their way. I will now move on to my own generation of lawyers. I call myself one of midnight's children, deeply influenced by the ideas and values of the freedom struggle. But what was the freedom struggle? Justice D.Y. Chandrachud describes it eloquently in Indian Lung Lawyers Association as follows. Reading Dr. Ambedkar compels us to look at the other side of independence movement. Besides the struggle for independence from the British rule, there was another struggle going on for centuries. And this was the struggle for social emancipation. It has been the struggle for independence of an unequal social order. It has been the fight for undoing of historical injustices and for righting fundamental wrongs with fundamental rights. The Constitution of India is the end product of both these struggles. It is the foundational document, which is the text and spirit, aims at social transformation, namely the creation and the preservation of an equal social order. The Constitution represents the aspirations of those who were denied the basic ingredients of a dignified existence. Close quotes. It is this approach that has guided my own lawyering over the last 50 years. There is no doubt that the journey in law was inspired as Justice Venkat Chelaya points out, by public interest litigation developed by judges like Bhagwati and Krishnayar. Without them, our efforts would have been as nothing. He has referred to two of the cases which I argued, the Olga Tellis case for the rights of pavement dwellers and the Bombay Hawkers case for the rights of hawkers, both of which dealt with the right to livelihood and dignity. These were cases which were brought to court the concerns of the disinherited of the earth. Hawkers, feriwalas, homeless, the rights of the self-employed, vegetable vendors, the rights of tribals and nomads, and the rights of women to hawk on the streets of Ahmedabad through Seva. Subsequent developments in PIL jurisdiction must be left for another day. We are yet to conclude what is the impact of opening the doors to anyone. Nor can now one single resident of Delhi can file a PIL questioning a whole movement of farmers on the ground that he is, quote unquote, a taxpayer, and hence has the locus to stop a protest of a whole community. Individual rights have the potential to defeat collective rights, a very dangerous precedent. I say no more, except that the voice of a generation of tax lawyers, a generation which sees its own individual convenience over all else. Way back in 1984, when I was arguing the Olga Tellis case, we were told that pavement drillers are, quote unquote, a nuisance and need to be removed from the, just like boxes and benches need to be removed from the pavements of Municipal Corporation of Bombay. Mind you, this is all recorded in the judgment. For those of you who care to read it, you will see that the argument of the Bombay Municipal Corporation was that the pavement dwellers are a nuisance. They were not called the homeless, they were called a nuisance. We then move on to the era of the national law schools. These lawyers who came out of national law schools were ideally suited to a neoliberal politics, to structural adjustment, and to the demands of a globalized economy. They entered the comfort zones of the hallowed law firms, giving a go-by to litigation. Regulatory agencies assumed importance. Electricity, infrastructure, and internet were the new havens for lawyers. Surprisingly, anti-competition law did not find the place that it should have. Finally, recent developments have seen young lawyers come to the aid of those who have been arrested in the Delhi riots, of people on social media who are being told that they are disrupting communal harmony, of lawyers who are fighting so-called conspiracies in every nook and corner. This gives hope for the future. If the 20th century bar in India was an anglicized bar influenced by Oxbridge alumni and barristers, the bar of the 21st century in India appears to be mainly Americanized, with ideas brought home by LLM doctorates from the alumni of Ivy League universities such as Harvard, Pennsylvania, and Columbia. But coming back to the issue at hand, this is the pool of talent from which we draw our judges. And while making appointments, we must be conscious as to what is the ideology of the person we are appointing. This, of course, brings me to what I have called the ideological court. Some have called it the executive court. The evidence is on the table. From the decision in Babri Masjid to the decision to put in cold storage CAA electoral bonds, a challenge to abolition of 370, from the grant of bail to some journalists and not to others, we see evidence of a highly self-conscious court. But perhaps this is a charitable description. What we really have is more than one Supreme Court of India, and sometimes more than one person in the personality of one judge. A pick and choose policy is what we see, perhaps the power vesting with the master of the roster. A majoritarian government brings with it its own perils, as pointed out by Justice Venkatachalaya himself. Well, can we say that it succumbs, that the judiciary succumbs to a majoritarian government? Are we seeing a threatened judiciary? Are we seeing a repeat of ADM Jabalpur, where one of the judges said, "I have a diamond hard hope that the state will treat its children in detention, its citizens in detention as its own children." Now, back to appointment of judges. In the United States, at least, we have the benefit of transparency, where every judge prior to appointment is questioned on their attitude to the issues of our times, abortion, the wall of separation between religion and state, and the rights of the LGBT community. In India, we have the worst of both worlds. We do not have that kind of transparency. And yet we know that a consensus which is built between the judiciary and the executive does have the last word. I propose instead an equal opportunities manner of appointment of judges. I propose that applications be invited for the appointment of judges from interested people, putting on record their bio data. This, I suggest, will ensure that women's, Dalits, LGBT community will all have an equal opportunity to get appointed as judges, and the judiciary will reflect the issues of this very diverse nation, diversity in terms of religion, language, and culture. We are now in a post-COVID world. Not surprisingly, the pandemic has made the rich richer and the poor poorer. Our challenges are many. Our primary challenge today is our food security, which is thought to be dismantled through a threat to the supply chain being monopolized by big business. These are the challenges which will find their way into the judiciary sooner, if not later. And I'd like to end by saying that we in this country should be prepared to appoint the best possible people, men and women, for the job of sitting on our Supreme Courts and our High Courts, and indeed all our other courts. Thank you very much.